comes to sing my great Redeemer's praise. The glories of my God and King, the triumphs of
my
His grace.
Master and my God, assist me to proclaim.
Thank you. be seated. Well, it's great to have so many family, friends, and guests. This is our second graduation in this academic year, and it's nice to have it back to normal. And so we started the year having a graduation for last academic year and had to be social distanced and limited. And I just felt that with all the hard work that these graduates have put in, they should be able to invite every aunt, uncle, friend that would like to come see them graduate. And so we are not social distancing, obviously. And hopefully you've taken precautions that you're comfortable with. We'll be hand sanitizing as they go across, but we are thrilled to have a normal graduation and celebrate all the hard work that these graduates have done. Please join me in thanking God for allowing us to have this year and all the hard work that these graduates have done. Dear Heavenly Father, we come today and thank you. God, we thank you for each graduate. Lord, I thank you for all the hard work that they have put in. But God, I know for many, if not all of them, they've been investing so that they can invest in others. They've been learning not for knowledge's sake, but they've been learning so that they can make a difference in someone else's life. And God, I believe that these graduates will make a difference. As I've gotten to know many of these graduates throughout their years here, I'm convinced that these graduates will serve you faithfully, that they will love others passionately, and that they'll be greatly used by you wherever you take them. And God, as we witness the end of their schooling here at Faith, but God, we're excited to see how you're going to continue to shape and mold them in the years ahead. Thank you for all of the family and friends who have supported them in this journey, both financially and through prayer. And God, I pray this is a wonderful moment for every parent who's here today, for every grandparent who's here today, for every friend, to see that person that they have invested in, that they have loved, reach this tremendous milestone. Bless this service today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I invite you to stand, and we'll sing How Great Thou Art. The text for the hymn is on page 15 of your commencement program.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
You may be seated.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Psalm 2, 1 through 3. We'll have two passages. The first one is the second Psalm, verses 1 through 3. Why do the nations rage and the people plot a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, "Let us break their bonds in pieces and cast away their cords from us." The second passage is 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And also, if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. The hardworking farmer must be first to partake of the crops. Consider what I say, and may the Lord give you understanding in all things.
Thank you.
Dr. Doug McLaughlin has served as the pastor of First Baptist Church in New Ulm, Minnesota, Bethany Baptist Church in Grand Blanc, Michigan, and Fourth Baptist Church in Plymouth, Minnesota. He's a senior pastor at Fourth Baptist, and while he was there, he served as the president of Central Baptist Theological Seminary and taught in the areas of homiletics and pastoral theology. Between his two comings to Fourth, he served at Northern Baptist Bible College as chairman of the Department of Bible and Graduate Studies. Following his retirement in 2007, he continues to engage in writing and Bible conference ministry and serves as the chancellor of Central Seminary. He is a humble theologian. He was my professor in college, and my wife served as his admin. He was the guy when I was in college that everyone wanted to preach like. He's been one of my counselors in the biggest decisions of my life. He and his wife Marie have left an imprint on Joan and me, and we are deeply grateful. It's my privilege to introduce this year's commencement speaker, Dr. Doug McLaughlin.
Thank you, my brother. Good morning. Mr. President, distinguished faculty, administration and staff, members of the board of directors, especially parents and grandparents and extended family members and friends, and most especially these honored graduates of Faith's 2021 class. Congratulations to the members of this class, every one of you. We honor you today. It's a privilege for me to be here. My subject this morning is the Benevolent Revolution. Serving redemptively and rescuingly for the sake of the gospel and the name of Jesus Christ in a hostile world. The global conspiracy portrayed in Psalm 2, 1-3, which Dr. Craig read to us just a moment ago, the global conspiracy portrayed in that psalm in those three verses is a portrait of the 21st century malevolent revolution which seems to have gotten a hold on the jugular of our civilization. The verbiage is graphic and defiant. The goal of the revolution, espoused in Psalm 2, 1-3, the goal of the revolution is the dethronement of God's anointed King Jesus Christ and the enthronement of autonomous humankind, James Boyce said. This hate speech, and that's what it really is, five defiant propositions in Psalm 2, 1-3, this hate speech defines the shape of our world today. Why do the nations rage? Pictures a noisy assemblage in defiance of the Lord and his Son. It's antipathy for Christ in Scripture. In particular, I think it's antipathy for certain key biblical realities which are hotly contested in the contemporary world. This psalm was written 3,000 years ago. But these key biblical realities are hotly contested because they strike at the heart of the malevolent revolution. Realities like this, divine creation versus Darwinian evolution. Sanctity of life versus secularism's love affair with death. Take a look at Proverbs 8, 35 and 36 to see if there isn't a love affair with death. Absolute truth versus postmodern anti-truth. Biblical sexuality versus the LGBTQ plus steamroller. And the deity and exclusivity of Jesus Christ versus philosophical pluralism. These are key issues. Creation, life, truth, sexuality, Christ. These are all front page, hot button controversies in the contemporary rage against the Lord and his Messiah Son. This is why the nations are raging. This is why the peoples plot a vain thing. This is why the kings of the earth set themselves, literally take their stand against the Lord and his anointed. This is why the rulers take counsel together They join together as one is the idea in conspiratorial global unity. When they can find no common cause among themselves, they can always find common cause against the Lord and against his anointed. And this is why they cry out, as that last verse in Psalm 2, and that little segment of Psalm 2 says, let us break in pieces there, that is, the Lord and his Son. Let us break in pieces their bonds and cast away their cords from us. Peter C. Craigie translates that phrase, tear off all these fetters, cast off all these cords. This is the world into which Faith's 2021 graduates are called to carry the gospel, which is the one and only liberating message capable of redeeming a society like ours through Great Commission living. Against this backdrop of hostility for Christ and his followers, I want to identify two indispensable commitments that all true believers in Jesus must embrace, and especially we're challenging our graduating class with them, but every single one of us who named the name of Christ, these are commitments that all true believers in Jesus must embrace if we hope to serve redemptively and join in what I'm calling the benevolent, not the malevolent, the malice-induced, the hate-induced revolution, the benevolent revolution. They're grounded in 2 Timothy 2, and I'm going to lift three verses out and identify two commitments. The first commitment is the daring of a soldier. I call you to that, the daring of a soldier. You, therefore, must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life that he may please him who has enlisted him to be a soldier. The daring of a soldier, and there's no doubt at all that war is being waged right here and right now on planet Earth. It's a devastating war with multiple casualties littering the landscape of planet Earth and of our own civilization here in the United States. But Paul says not to worry, because our Christian warfare is fundamentally different from conventional warfare. The kind of warfare in which we are to engage, which you are to engage as you graduate, the kind of warfare in which we are to be engaged is not lethal and death-inducing. It's liberational and life-inducing. We don't stab people into death with the sword of the assassin. We stab people into life with the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. What kind of soldiers will be needed for this kind of combat? Noble, benevolent combat. Well, I think Paul says two or three things about that in verses 3 and 4. Let me go through them quickly. I'm trying to do it quickly. One, we're to be sacrificial in outlook. You must endure hardship as good soldiers of Jesus Christ. You must endure. It's in the imperative mode. He just says, endure hardship. He just says it. Imperative mode, the command. Endure hardship. Expect it in this kind of world. Paul is insisting that our focus should not be on luxuriant peacetime lifestyles, because there's a war going on all around us. We are engaged in a great struggle for the preservation of truth and the redemption of lost souls. So our calling is to live our lives unencumbered with non-essentials. A phrase that is not my own, but which I cherish. We're to live our lives unencumbered with non-essentials so that wartime effectiveness can be achieved. And this means that we must be ready to accept hardship and risk and sacrifice, all of which are endemic to, that is, native to, soldiering. That's what soldiers do. We must be prepared to embrace our share of the suffering as we surrender to a great commandment love for Jesus Christ and a great commission passion for lost people who are in bondage to evil and the evil one, who are actually casualties of the malevolent revolution. There's a second credential. Not only are we to be sacrificial in outlook, but we are to be singular in focus. No one engaged in warfare. And I think that phrase means no one on active duty. Excuse me. No one on active duty entangles himself with the affairs of this life. He has a singular focus. Roman soldiers were focused. Paul knew this. He spent a lot of time with him. He did a lot of time in prison. His crime was Christ. Paul knew that Roman soldiers had a singular purpose, and that was to serve the dictates of the Caesar. And we are called to the same level of focused service wherever God sovereignly and strategically places each one of these graduates. We're not to be entangled with the affairs of this life because we are all on active duty for Christ, serving as soldiers in the benevolent revolution. Of course, we have to deal responsibly with the affairs of this life. That's true. And Paul says that in multiple other occasions in his epistles, his letters in the New Testament. One such example is 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 11 and 12. We have to deal responsibly with the affairs of this life. The business of this bios is what I think a literal rendering of that phrase. We have to deal responsibly with the affairs of this life, but we are not to be entangled with them. I'm sorry. I believe entanglement suggests an excessive preoccupation, sometimes even obsession with the physical, the material, the comfortable, the financial, to the exclusion of the spiritual, the moral, and the missional. Paul, I think, is warning us against a love affair with the cosmos, the world system, the world's worldview. He's warning us against being seduced by the glitz and the glamour and the gold of the world system, because surrendering to that seduction suffocates authentic Christian living, suppresses Great Commission passion, and stifles the progress of the benevolent revolution. Be sacrificial in outlook, be singular in focus. And Paul says we're to be selfless in spirit, that we may please him, not ourselves, that we may please him who has enlisted us to be a soldier. Ever since the cosmic catastrophe in the Garden of Eden, humankind and every one of us, including Doug, humankind has been infected with a slavish infatuation with the self. Nothing pulls more powerfully on our fallen nature than this infatuation. Living as though I am the epicenter of the universe and that life is all about me, I like to call it ego cubed. Ego raised to the third power, me, myself, I. All of this is a manifestation of pleasing ourselves rather than pleasing him who has enlisted us as a soldier. And like Jesus, you and I must be willing to say, I do always those things that please not myself. I do always those things which please my Father. The first duty of every authentic Christian soldier is unconditional surrender to Christ's sovereignty, uncontested obedience to Christ's authority, because we love him. This is doing what God says, as Les Olala has taught us for decades, wonderfully taught us. This is doing what God says completely, when God says it immediately, with the right heart attitude, joyfully. Christian soldiers do always those things which please their commander in chief. So I call you to the daring of a soldier, and secondly, to the devotion of an athlete. And that's in verse 5. And also, Paul says, he's using metaphors in this text of Scripture to illustrate what it means to be a Christian in a hostile world. And the second metaphor is that of an athlete. And also, if anyone competes in athletics, this is the New King James translation, if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. Paul was acquainted with world-class athletics in the Greco-Roman world of which he was a part. He traveled throughout it for many years. World-class athletics. We may not be world-class athletes. Probably none of us are. Maybe a few are. But we are called to a world-class task. And our task, as a part of the benevolent revolution, is infinitely greater in character and value than any athletic event, whatever its platform. Now, what shape does this take? And I'll hurry through it. What shape does this take? I think there are two mandates that illustrate it. What does this look like according to verse 5? The first is what I'm going to call the call to holy sweat. Paul's word is athleo. That's the Greek word. Competes in athletics. The word is athleo. It implies significant expenditures of energy And as thus, it includes the rigor of sweat. Thank you. I'll try to get rid of this frog. Thanks for that. It includes the rigor of sweat, which is sourced in devotion and ends in discipline. This is an athletic metaphor. Did you ever ask yourself, why do athletes sweat like that? Or you might have asked, why do their lockers and their jerseys and their tennis shoes smell like that? And the answer is, they love the sport, so they welcome the sweat. And that's what I mean by the devotion of an athlete. It's a call to holy sweat. It mandates the discipline to say no to ourselves so that we can say yes to Christ and to others who have needs. But saying no to ourselves, I don't know how it is for you. Saying no to ourselves is not easy for any one of us, not for me, not for you. Ever since the catastrophe in Eden, human beings have been hardwired to stroke and coddle and pamper the self rather than say no to self. You remember the history? I'll take only a moment on it. You remember the history? In Eden, God gave Adam and Eve. Do you remember this? In Eden, God gave Adam and Eve a superabundant yes. Every tree, freely eat. Superabundant yes, Genesis 2:16. Then he gave them a solitary no. One no. One tree, don't eat. Just to prove that you love me and will obey me, even if you don't understand the reason for it. A superabundant yes, every tree freely eat. A solitary no, one tree, don't eat. They couldn't resist the solitary no. They had to overthrow it. And ever since, we have found it almost impossible to say no to ourselves. Only the grace of God can enable us to do so. Paul has already said it in verse 1 of this chapter. And in Titus 2, verses 11 and 12, Paul says this, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us." What does the grace of God teach us? The grace of God teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly lust. The word in English customarily is denying. The Greek word is arnaomai, and it means to say no. The grace of God teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly lust, and to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this now age, this present age. It's only God's saving, sustaining, and strengthening grace that makes us willing and able to say no to our selfish aspirations so that we can say yes to holy sweat in the service of Christ and a lost humanity. And the second mandate arising from the athletic metaphor is what I'm going to call the call to radical obedience, where Paul says, if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned. He is not crowned unless he competes nomenos, lawfully or according to the rules, which for us in the Christian faith means in accordance with biblical orthodoxy, in accordance with God's word, doing God's ministry in God's way, in accordance with God's word for God's glory. Grace is a very disciplined virtue. It enables us to say no, and it quickens us to obey. By the way, all the metaphors in the passage that was read earlier, 2 Timothy 2, all the metaphors here for Christian service in this passage carry with them discipline codes of conduct. Disciplers in verse 2, soldiers in verses 3 and 4, competitors or athletes in verse 5, and farmers in verse 6. And we're to think very soberly about this according to verse 7, that word consider. Think this over. Think very soberly about these metaphors, Paul says. They're all of the metaphors require disciplined codes of conduct. And this is not a call for some form of Christian legalism. What motivates serious athleticism is not law, but love for the sport. What drives holy sweat and obedience to the cause of Christ is not legalism, but great commandment love for the God we worship and cherish, and great commission compassion for the lost world we care about. It's this kind of Holy Spirit-generated love and compassion that rescues us from brute legalism and opens our hearts to holy sweat and radical obedience in behalf of the benevolent revolution. Now I close with this. I think it's apparent that in these verses that Paul's message and mandate is not a call to an easy life, but it is a call to a great life. In effect, Paul is saying this to you and me. This is how I've looked at it. I've been in a little over 50 years in Christian ministry after graduation from Central Seminary. This is how it looks to me, what it says to me. Doug, that's me. You can put your name in the equation. Doug, if you want a life of easygoing self-indulgence, of light, L-I-T-E, Christianity, of bargain basement discipleship, of couch potato lazing, or of cheap grace, as Bonhoeffer put it. If that's what you want, Paul is saying, whatever you do, don't bother becoming a follower of Jesus. But if you long for a life that is perfectly suited to the nature God gave you as a creature made in his image, and as Christ gave to you as a sinner reborn into his family with that new nature, if you want a life that is perfectly suited to that wonderful nature and that which nothing else will satisfy that nature, if you want that, then I think Paul is saying, embrace the daring of a soldier. Be sacrificial in outlook, singular in focus, selfless in disposition and spirit, and embrace the devotion of an athlete, the call to holy sweat, the call to radical obedience on the ground of biblical orthodoxy. It doesn't mean, by the way, to this graduating class, it doesn't mean that we all have to be pastors or missionaries or professors. It means that whatever our vocation or calling in life might be, we must first and foremost be true and dedicated and tenacious and persistent and tireless followers of Jesus, tracing our lives according to the pattern we see in him, and tracing our lives according to the word we hear from him in the New Testament. With all my heart, I pray that this marvelous class of 2021 at Faith Baptist Bible College and Seminary will be such a class, and that you will be willing to pay the price, the daring of a soldier, the devotion of an athlete, that you will be willing to pay the price to join the benevolent revolution. God's very best to every one of you.
Okay, now my turn. Thank you, Anna. That was worth waiting for. Appreciate that. Earlier this morning, we recognized students who had achieved great awards. And in a few minutes, we're going to recognize students who have achieved the standard of graduation, which is a high standard. Obviously, you can probably imagine academics is a works-based system, isn't it? You do the work, you get the reward. But you know, there's another realm that's not a works-based system, and that's in the spiritual realm. And the achievement is not something that we can earn. In fact, it's something that none of us can earn that standard, because the standard is perfection. And it's my joy to reiterate for all of us the fact that we need to reach that standard, but there's no way we can. But because of God's grace, we all have that opportunity. For by grace you are saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. You know, if that's your need today, we don't want to assume anything. If you're here, there's nothing greater you could rejoice with your graduate about today, later today, is that the fact that you got saved. That is, you put your trust for the forgiveness of your sins in Christ's death on the cross, because that's the standard we have to reach, perfection. But our sins keep us from that. And you know, it would be a great joy for your graduate to know that that's a decision you made today. If that's your need, I encourage you to make that decision. Ask your graduate. I'm sure they would love to explain the gospel to you. And now it's on to the workspace side of things. Dr. Tillotson, as Vice President for Academic Services at Faith Baptist Bible College, it gives me great pleasure on behalf of the college faculty to present to you the class of 2021. These individuals have fulfilled the requirements of their various programs of study as specified in the college catalog, making them eligible for participation in this ceremony. They are now ready to receive their diplomas. A number of graduates will also receive honor seals on their diplomas corresponding to the college academic achievement of honors, high honors, or highest honors. All graduates receiving a bachelor's degree will also receive a towel as a lifelong reminder that greatness is defined by service, not position. The towel is embroidered with the school name, logo, and these three words: be great, serve. Dr. Tillotson, I present to you the class of Faith Baptist Bible College 2021.
Those receiving the Biblical Worldview Certificate, please stand. The certificate requires a program completion of at least 32 credit hours of academic study. Zachary William Lobb. Kyla Vugdeveen.
Upon recommendation of the faculty and with the authorization of the Board of Directors, as President of Faith Baptist Bible College and Theological Seminary, I confer upon you the Biblical Worldview Certificate with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations.
Please be seated. Those receiving the Associate of Arts degree, please stand. This degree requires a program completion of at least 62 credit hours of academic study. Ashley Samantha Avery. Erica Naomi Brown. Tyler Carson. Sofia Victoria Chiesa. Jaden Gehrig. Kylie Gehrig. Kate Lundahl. Heidi M. Olson. Esther Overfors. Adriana Rice. Tabitha Van Unen.
Upon recommendation of the faculty and with the authorization of the Board of Directors, as President of Faith Baptist Bible College and Theological Seminary, I confer upon you the degree of Associate of Arts with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations.
Please be seated. Those receiving the Bachelor of Science degree, please stand. This degree requires a program completion of at least 122 credit hours of academic study. Stephanie Lynn Bartlett. Caitlin Nicole Beckman. Catriel Anita Brown. Krista Lynn Brown. Amelia Hope Caves. Alicia Smith Clark. Brian Alden Demers Jr. Patricia Patefield Dempsey. Max Detzel. Natalie Louise Dirksen. Karis Ruth Gigerich. Joel Graham II. Joseph S. Graham. Alyssa Hathcock. Benjamin Paul Huggins. Da Za May. Trey Micah Niemeyer. Dakota Andrew Nyhart. Samuel Pedersen. Anna Grace Plorence. Bethany Ann Roberts. Megan A. Rye. Eku Shi. Anna Smith. Jenna Lynn Stupke. Jenna Toomey. Stephanie Torres. Rebecca Ann Vermillion. Kara Marie Walton. Caleb Winey. Gabrielle Marie Wood. Allison Grace Ewan. Reed Zernhelt. Abby Zollinger.
Upon the recommendation of the faculty, with the authorization of the Board of Directors, as the President of Faith Baptist Bible College and Theological Seminary, I confer upon you the degree of Bachelor of Science with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations.
Please be seated. Those receiving the Bachelor of Arts degree, please stand. This degree requires a program completion of at least 122 credit hours of academic study, including 4 semesters of a foreign language. Jennifer Lynn Bjorquist. Jeffrey Dillard. Sunny Forrest Gridley. Scott Eiler. Isaac D. Jaspers. Alexis Joy Lindo. Jacob M. Stillwell. Rebecca Preston Sturgis. Seth Harrison Thompson. Luke Triber.
On the recommendation of the faculty, with the authorization of the Board of Directors, as President of Faith Baptist Bible College and Theological Seminary, I confer upon you the degree of Bachelor of Arts with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations.
Please be seated.
I want to bring a brief challenge to the graduates this year of the seminary. It's a privilege to have a smaller class, but really a sharp class, and we're looking forward to what God is going to do and continue to do in your life and ministry. If you think about ministry, often in Scripture it's referred to as a race. It's a competition. And so I have one more quiz for you here to be able to get out of this place. I only have two questions, and it's multiple choice. The Apostle Paul talks about his race, and in 2 Timothy, he said, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. Here's the question. Where was Paul in his race for Jesus Christ? Was he A, at the beginning of the race, B, at the end of the race, or C, I do not know? B, correct. That's very good. You know, Paul, as he wrote 2 Timothy, it's his last will and testament, and he wrote it to Timothy to encourage him to keep going in the race. Earlier in the book, he refers to the race like this. He says, and these things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. So I brought up an object lesson here for you to kind of remember this. This is a baton. And what we find out is that the Christian race is not run just as an individual. It's run as a relay race. And what he says here is that he wants to commit the things that he has taught Timothy so that Timothy can then commit those things to others. And the word commit, I really want to focus on this. It's an imperative. And it is the word paratithemi. It means to entrust something to someone. During your stay here at seminary, you've learned sound doctrine. You've learned to articulate the gospel and the truths and the great truths of Orthodox Christianity. And this is something that's been entrusted to you. It's been committed to you. And now it's up to you to go out and to do that. So here's the second question. Are you ready? Again, it's multiple choice. As you think about the race that you're in, where are you in the race? A, are you at the beginning? B, are you at the end? Or C, I haven't figured that out yet. A is correct. Good job, Brandon. I guess we'll let you guys out of here. We'll let you out. You think about it, graduation is a great time to celebrate what's been accomplished. All of those tests, you know, the Greek projects, the Hebrew projects, hermeneutics, it's been a mountain of things to get through. One of our graduates has been in seminary for 18 years, you know, praise the Lord, Josh, you're making it. But really, it's a commencement. It's just the beginning of the race. And I just want to challenge you to take the baton and train and commit yourselves to passing the truth on to others so that the race can continue. Dr. Tillotson, as the Dean of Faith Baptist Theological Seminary, it gives me great pleasure on behalf of the seminary faculty to present to you the class of 2021. These individuals have completed their various courses of graduate study and fulfilled the requirements for graduation as specified in our seminary catalog. They are now ready to receive their diplomas. A number of graduates will also receive honor seals on their diplomas corresponding to the seminary honors of cum laude, magna cum laude, and summa cum laude. All seminary graduates will also receive a towel as a lifelong reminder that greatness is defined by service, not position. The towel is printed with the school name and logo and three words, Be great, serve. Dr. Tillotson, I present to you the Faith Baptist Theological Seminary graduating class of 2021.
Those receiving the Master of Arts in Religion degree, please stand. This degree requires a program completion of at least 32 credit hours of academic study. Brandon Fritz. Aaron Mozzarella.
Upon recommendation of the faculty, with the authorization of the Board of Directors, as President of Faith Baptist Bible College and Theological Seminary, I confer upon you the degree of Master of Arts in Religion with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations.
Those receiving the Master of Arts degree, please stand. This degree requires a program completion of at least 36 credit hours of academic study. Daniel Richard Brutkel. Charity Ann Mapes.
Upon recommendation of the faculty, with the authorization of the Board of Directors, as President of Faith Baptist Bible College and Theological Seminary, I confer upon you the degree of Master of Arts with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations.
Those receiving the Master of Divinity degree, please stand. There they go again. This degree requires a program completion of at least 96 credit hours of academic study. Daniel Richard Brutkel. Charity Ann Mapes. Joshua A. Wasson.
Upon recommendation of the faculty, with the authorization of the Board of Directors, as President of Faith Baptist Bible College and Theological Seminary, I confer upon you the degree of Master of Divinity with all the rights and privileges pertaining thereto. Congratulations.
Please be seated.
You may be seated. What a great day of celebration, and we wanted to just interject a moment to celebrate what a great job our president has done. He's 6 years into the project. The project. I'm sorry, I misspoke. And going into seven, little did he know what God was leading him into, to leave Canada, leave a great pastoral ministry, come to a school that needed great leadership, and work through a great flood that many will remember for years to come, work through a pandemic. And so the look is up, and the best days are still ahead. So we're glad for that. And I believe Joan is with us as well. And Joan, if you'd make your way to the platform, thank you. Mr. President. We just want to say thank you to God for what a great leader you are, a great president, a wonderful pastor, and such a good friend. We know that you've made a new family here in Central Iowa with not only the students and families here, but with many other families throughout the United States. And so we're grateful for that. We also know that you like to give surprises. So you didn't know about this, and so we've just got a little surprise for you today. And as much as you've traveled, and you're pretty much a northerner, have you ever been to hillbilly country?
Yes, we have.
You have, okay. And you know what we're talking about. So there's a great place to go for that. And so we have here, on behalf of the board of directors, and I would say the faculty and staff and students, and this is why this moment was selected, to present to you a certificate of appreciation to Dr. Jim and Joan Tillotson, an all expense paid 3-day trip to Big Cedar Lodge in Branson, Missouri, in appreciation of your distinguished servant leadership as President and First Lady of FBBC&TS.
Thank you very much.
As you may know, there's a lot to do in Branson, so you'll get to pick and select those kinds of things, but we want to make sure that you also get 2 tickets to the performance of Jesus at the Sight and Sound Theater in Branson, Missouri. Again, in appreciation of your distinguished servant leadership and President and First Lady of FBBC&TS.
If I have to watch a timeshare presentation, I will not be that happy. Well, as I thought about what I'd want to say as we close, I really want to direct it to the graduating class in the college. You were the first class that caused us to grow here at Faith. 2 weeks before you showed up, Mark Davis came in my office. He said, "Jim, we have a problem." And I said, "What's that?" He said, "All those kids." I said, "Yeah." He said, "They're really coming." And we had not prepared for that. We had not seen growth in 10 years. And we had to flip an apartment into a girls' dorm in 2 weeks. That sounds easy, but that was a lot of hard work. We called every friend we knew, and it was all hands on deck, and we flipped that apartment and turned it into a girls' dorm. And actually, since your class came, we've grown every year since then. Then, between your freshman and sophomore year, we had a flood hit our campus, 10 inches of rain in 2 hours. June 30th, 2018, a date I will never forget. And found out that insurance wouldn't cover it. $250,000 damage to our campus, 11 buildings flooded. Seemed like an impossible task. You helped us move into Domokos Hall. We had a wonderful plan, except the night before to move in, we got 8 inches of snow. And Kurt called me 6:30 in the morning, said, "I've been plowing all night. I haven't even shoveled any sidewalk. There's no way we can move today." And I said, "How many shovels do you have?" He said, "I think I got 10. I said, "Great, I'm gonna meet the students in the chapel." I went and I said, "How many of you students are from Minnesota and Michigan?" A bunch of hands went up. I said, "Great, you guys know how to shovel. We need help." And they all immediately jumped up and began shoveling. We moved 26 offices in 2 hours. We then went into Refresh, which experienced a polar vortex, 3 days of minus 40. You saw the death of a classmate. We came back into school and we were redoing this gym. Our gym kind of looked like the old gym in Hoosiers. We had the old lights and we had redone the floor. They used a new product. And due to a lot of things outside of our control, we couldn't use the gym really almost till November, which meant that all our chapels were in the classrooms here, 103, 104, 105, and those classrooms could not have desks. So for those 3 months, every student just had to hold their laptop and their books in their lap. The volleyball team never had a home game. Our volleyball team played at Ankeny Christian for their home games. They couldn't practice in this gym, and I never received one crabby letter from a parent or a volleyball player, although I certainly felt I would have deserved that. You were here when we had to cancel our campus. Last school year, we had 1 day's notice to send all of you home. We gathered here in a lot of tears and sent everyone home and finished the year online. You came back this year in time to help us clean up our campus that was hit hard by the derecho. You went through the challenges of COVID and the quarantining of our campus for 10 days last semester. The many schedule changes in athletics and music due to COVID, the chorale not being able to travel over spring break this year, the canceling of our Israel trip. When I thought of all the tragedies and challenges that we've gone through on our campus during your 4 years here, two truths struck me. Number one, you are really bad luck. But number two, we have a great God. And I would just challenge you. Some people would read about God's great work, but you've seen it. You saw people come from all over America who did not know you so that we could start school on time. An 80-year-old and a 75-year-old wife sitting in a church in Elyria who heard that we had flooded and needed 100 people to rip out all of the drywall 4 feet and down, walked out of that service and drove through the night to show up on our campus, worked 3 days straight, stayed in the girls' dorm, and when they left a $10,000 check behind to help. You know that we did start school on time, seeming impossibility. People gave the $250,000 and all the things that we could go on to say how God provided. Dalton passed away as a poor Bible college student. There wasn't enough money to do his funeral, but you gave. And in 2 weeks, all the money that was needed to cover his funeral primarily came from you. We announced a polar vortex. A pastor in Iowa called and said, "My car won't run in minus 40. I can't come." I got up and shared that with you. And so let's pray for all the pastors who need a break, who need to come. As I walked off the platform, 7 of you lined up, and every one of you said the same thing to me. "I'll go get them. I'll go pick them up, and I'll bring them back." When COVID hit, as we went through all the challenges of quarantining, the way you cared for each other, we had a student this last semester whose mother was killed in a car accident. And the next day I came to chapel, Brandon Fritz came and said, "Hey, the guys in the dorm have gotten all their money together. They want to pay for him to fly home and his wife." You've seen some wonderful things that God can do. And I would just say to all of you, I hope you never forget. That's why we take communion. We forget easily. But I hope when you look back at what God's done over these 4 years, you remember that you saw we had a lot of challenges. Maybe no four-year class has been through what you've been through, but you've seen God show up. Someone told me once, what God brings you to, God will bring you through. And I would just say, being the first class that caused growth, and the amazing way you've responded has been a wonderful blessing to me personally. And just personally, I'll miss you guys. And you know I love you. But there's a lot of people out there who haven't seen what you've seen. And they need to know we have an amazing God. I don't really think you're bad luck. But I do think we have a great God. I'm excited of how God's going to use every single one of you for the cause of Christ. We love you guys. Let me close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for these graduates. God, as we reflect over what they've been through, but God, as we've seen how they have responded, God, they've responded in love for each other. They've responded in love for you. These challenges have not caused them to quit. These challenges have solidified in their hearts, as we heard Dr. McLaughlin say, they would have the endurance of a soldier, the endurance of an athlete. And God, I pray that wherever you're going to take these graduates, they'll never forget the lessons they learned here in the classroom and out of the classroom. I pray that the friendships that they developed over these 4 years would remain the rest of their life. God, not only with each other, but also with the faculty and staff here. God, may they always be reminded that there is a group of people here at Faith who will always have their back, will always be there for them if they need it, will be cheering them on in every success. And God, we pray your richest blessing on each one of these graduates. Thank you for bringing them here to Faith. Thank you for the privilege we've had to serve you together over these past years. And God, again, we thank you for all the family and friends who've invested in them and helped them to accomplish this goal. I pray that you'd bless each of them as well. I believe we all stand here incredibly grateful and thankful to you for what you have done in our lives. God, we love you. I pray that we would communicate that to those around us. Thank you for getting us through this year. Thank you for allowing us to have this graduation ceremony. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There is a reception for our honorees over in Benson from 12 to 1:30. If you're not familiar with Benson, just walk to the far end of our campus. It's our dining hall. And so we have several honorees who last year and this year graduated. And if you would love to come over and congratulate them, many of them have invested in your students. And I know a lot of students have a lot of parties going on right away as well. But you are all invited to stop by and just congratulate our retirees. We're thankful for each one of them. Thank you so much for being here today.